For what categories of my life should I set goals? So goal setting is an important part of emotional management. One thing that we do want to distinguish when we talk about this is goals from ideals. So straight out of Google, what is a goal? The object of a person's ambition or effort. The definition of a goal encompasses all sorts of goals. So if you have an altruistic goal, which is to serve your community, it fits in there. If you have a goal to attain power and wealth through corrupt means, that's also a goal. It's a selfish goal. If you have a goal to seek revenge on others and so on and so forth. So a goal is simply the object of a person's ambition or effort. It doesn't tell us whether or not it's a worthwhile objective upon which to concentrate. And for those of you who have heard me speak, you'll recognize immediately that quote is from Martin Luther King. He talks about education as having a twofold purpose. First is to develop the power of concentration. The second is to develop worthy objectives upon which to concentrate. So the mere fact that we have a goal doesn't mean that it's a good thing necessarily. It may not be a worthwhile objective for us. And so this segues into the notion of an ideal. So an ideal is also a goal, but it's one that lies outside of self-interest. It doesn't mean that we replace our goals with ideals. In some cases that may happen. We may choose to replace an existing goal with an ideal outside of self-interest. But perhaps a better way to think about it is that it is something else that we add. So the reason that we have goals and ideals. There are different ways that we can describe the impediments to our growth and well-being. There's a range of them. The first of these is inertia, laziness, lack of effort, lack of interest. What we've broadly been talking about as tamas. So tamas is a Sanskrit word which refers to a particular quality of mind or a thought texture. So if we are in this state of having no interest, being indifferent to the world, to our own lives, the direction it's taking, then we lack any enthusiasm for any kind of action. This kind of stagnation of the personality is highly detrimental to our well-being and our growth. And so any goal is better than that, even if it's a selfish one. So we often give the story of Vivekananda, who was talking the knowledge of Vedanta, and his audience came up and said to him, okay, so what do we do? What's our spiritual practice? How can we grow and evolve? And he immediately commanded them, go play football. So one of the ways we can interpret what he says here is get out of your inertia. Start acting. Now, even if you want to play football for your own personal glory, so that you look good in front of others, you're showing off your skill and impressing people and attracting a mate and whatever it happens to be. Even if it's self-interest, it's better than being in that state of tamas, of inertia. So any goal will be better than having no goal, no direction, no purpose, no thing to achieve. If our goals, however, are imbued with selfish interest, that will also impede our growth and well-being. So we've been talking at length about the management of stress. And you know, we give different causes of stress, personal preferences of the mind, our likes and dislikes, etc. We can boil it down even further and say the cause of our stress, our mental agitation, is selfishness. We can explain more about how that functions. But selfish interest is essentially the cause of our stress. And so this is where an ideal comes in. An ideal is a goal that lies outside of that selfish interest. And so what we're doing is two things. We are circumventing that thought current of I want to get, what about me, etc. That thought of taking for yourself. So an ideal will circumvent that. The other thing that we're doing with an ideal is that we are taking advantage of the law of identification. It's the law that functions to promote spiritual growth or spiritual devolution, which is as you think, so you become. In the same way that you are what you eat, your body is made up of the food you've eaten, your inner personality is made up of the thoughts that you entertain. And so an ideal, consistently applied, develops the inner personality in a way that is less selfish. And so our growth and well-being are enhanced. And so the implications for this are that we can perform a self-analysis and look at those areas of our life where we are a little tamasic or inert. Look at those areas of our life where we are active, but we are rajasic, or that is to say, we have primarily selfish interest as the motivator. And where we have inertia, look for any goal in that area of life, even if it's selfish. Where we are already acting, now we can start to implement an ideal. So the question was, what categories should I set goals for? Goals should be set in every area of life. So the question is, where do you spend your time and attention? And it really comes down to attention rather than time, but time is a good proxy for it. So this requires some self-reflection. So what categories should you set goals for? You create those categories based on where you are spending your time, where you're spending your attention. The analogy we sometimes use is to look at your internet. If you could look across all of your devices, every moment that you've spent on the internet, you could categorize every web page, every app, every etc. across different domains. And in fact, if you look at your screen time app on your phone, it starts to do this for you. Okay, in the last 24 hours, I've spent 15% on games, and I've spent 20% on social media, and I've spent 20% on email. So think of the same thing, your mental bandwidth. Where is it going? So the only person who can answer that question is yourself. So it means there is some self-reflection required for you to create your own categories. Once you've figured out, generally speaking, where you spend your time and attention, we put them in order of importance. Importance for what? Well, importance for our growth and well-being. Again, this is what everything is directed towards. So the subtler the field of activity, the more important it will be for our happiness and our growth. The subtler aspects of our personality, when they are satisfied, deliver not just a finer quality of joy, but a more long-lasting quality of joy. So we always use the same very simple example to try and illustrate this idea. You have a big bag of cherries and you really love cherries. Now you can enjoy that whole bag on your own, and you're gaining the joy of sense contact. It's sensory pleasure. How long does it last? After you've finished the first cherry, your hand goes again back into the bag, and again back into the bag. The moment it's off the palate, taste is gone, the joy is gone. Now you imagine that you have the same big bag of cherries and you share them with your neighbor. What joy are you experiencing now? So this is an emotional joy. It's a subtler level of the personality. It's human connection. It's sharing. The quality of that joy is more. So the quality of joy is finer and it lasts. It sets you up. It holds the mind aloft in a more satisfying feeling for longer than merely eating them yourself. because you've contacted a subtler level of the personality. So the subtler fields will be more important for our well-being. And of course, the other aspect of the order of importance is the amount of time and attention you're actually spending. So this is what we need to do as we go through. And you pick for yourself the fields of activity where you spend your time and attention. But there are some common ones that we all share. So our physical health and lifestyle, eating habits, our exercise, our sleep, and all these things we spend time on. Our sexual and romantic life, you know, creating a partnership, our family life, parents, siblings, children, social life, the vocational side of life, so that's our choices of study and training, work and career. We might have a volunteering or altruistic side, self-development and spirituality, etc. So etc., because it's the last line of the page, means you fill in your own. So fill in those areas, those categories that make sense for you. So when it comes to the goals, what we can start to do is for each field of activity, simply ask yourself, what do I want? Now, this is not as easy as it sounds. Simple and easy are not the same thing. It's a simple question to answer, but it's not always easy to find out what we want. And our life's experience will often teach us this. I set a goal and I worked towards it, and then when I got it, I was sort of immediately happy, but then a creeping dissatisfaction and a sort of a malaise, and I wanted something else. So did I really want that? Because if I really wanted that, then surely I'd still be happy now that I have it. There's a beautiful quote in the Game of Thrones series. The king, after he had achieved the throne, he says, "I never felt half so alive as when I was vying for the throne. I don't feel half as dead now that I have it." When he was chasing the object of his desire, he felt alive. He thought, that's what I wanted. Then when he actually achieved the throne, I feel dead inside. So did he want the throne? Well, if you had asked him before, he would have said yes. Ask him after a decade of ruling, he said, "No, this whole thing, this is not what I wanted." So we should go into it with our eyes open to recognize that we may not know what we want. And in fact, in the book, The Fall of the Human Intellect, there's an entire section entitled, "You know not what you want." So it requires a little bit more reflection than we might otherwise think. What do I want? And then why do I want it? What am I getting out of it? Why do you want to be king? And so there are different ways that you can explore this idea. There are online resources to help you do this. If you just want to do it on your own, you can create imaginary scenarios and explore them. So some simple ones, you know, if I found the genie's lamp, if I had three wishes, what would I wish for? If I could have anything. So what is this doing? It's removing boundaries to allow your mind to explore its own interests and desires. Another one that you may be familiar with, and this is often used when it comes to helping students figure out what area of life they should go into for study. If money were no object, what would I choose? Because often we'll choose a field of study and career on the basis of being able to sustain myself materially, which is an important part of being a human, of course. But in terms of the exploration of what I want with my life, what would I do if I won the lottery and never needed to worry about housing, food, healthcare, for me, for my family? How would I spend my time? Oh, I'd go live on a ranch with horses, and I'd grow food, and I'd have bees, etc. So what is this showing you? It's starting to show you your areas of interest. So the goals that we set must be aligned to our own specific nature. So the phrase that we are familiar with is swadharma. The word swa means one's own. The word dharma means nature. So if you could rub the genie's lamp and have all the money in the world, one person goes and lives in a rural farming area, another person's living in the center of Manhattan. Why? Different natures. And so the exploration of who and what we are is an essential part of goal setting. We should not live another person's perfect life. We will be miserable in a perfect life for somebody else. So we must choose according to our nature rather than because of external pressure. Society says that you should raise a family. Your parents are giving you the pressure. When are you going to start a family? And also not because of convenience. There's a good engineering course at a local university, and my father, works high up in an engineering firm. I'm sure he can get me in a few years. That's convenient. It's good money. I'll do that. No. So external pressure and convenience are terrible reasons to choose a field of activity and to create a goal. So a couple of quotes that we've used in the past in discussion of this idea. So you may be familiar with Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs. A musician must make music, an artist must paint, a poet must write. If he is to be ultimately at peace with himself, what a man can be, he must be. So you'll forgive the monogendered language. But self-actualization, which is what he's talking about, as a diversion, not to be confused with self-realization, a very different concept. Self-actualization means that you function according to your swadharma, your own nature. If we don't, then no matter how successful we are, we will still be unhappy. He says, better is one's own duty, though devoid of merit, than duty of another well discharged. So he's saying here that if you live another person's nature, if you live according to what another person says are beautiful goals, and you do it perfectly and achieve success, you will be unhappy. If you are in your own field of endeavor, but don't achieve huge success, you will still be happy because you are functioning towards your own nature. And it's interesting here, the word swadharma we translate as one's own nature. Here he translates it as one's own duty. So what is your duty? It's determined by your nature. What's your obligation in life? Well, if your nature is to be a parent, your obligation is to be a parent. If your nature is to be child-free, your obligation is to be child-free. So your duty is determined by your inner nature, not by external circumstances or environments. So this starts to give us an understanding of where we can work with our goals. Once we have a goal, then we can start to work with ideals. So where the goal was essentially asking, what do I want? For an ideal, we can start to ask, what can I contribute? And so again, you take that field of activity that you have, and you take the goal that you have, and you add on to it. So we've got three very rudimentary examples here. So the first one is actually someone that I personally know. They are a successful lawyer, and they want to be a successful lawyer, and her job is to defend victims of corporate fraud. So that's where she puts all of her efforts. That's where her small company puts all of their efforts. Why? Well, not just because it's an area of life where we can, sustain the business, but for the small businesses or for the individuals who have been taken advantage of, we can come to their aid. So it's a sense of contributing not just to that individual, but to the society in general. So that's at the level of work and career. At the level of your physical body, your goal might be to stay healthy and disciplined. Why? Well, because I like being healthy. It's something that I just want for myself. How can I contribute outwardly while I'm doing that? Well, I can inspire others to stay active. So what do I do? Now, again, it depends upon your specific nature. But you might enlist other people into your weekly hikes or grab other people to train for an upcoming 10K run or half marathon. Why? Well, because I want to inspire others towards staying active as well. We know that physical health is an indicator of well-being, happiness. So it's contributing outwardly at the level of the body. At the level of, say, romance and emotions, I want to have a successful marriage. And of course, you could spend another hour trying to define exactly what that means, but let's just take it as given. Why? Well, because it's what I want. It's what I need. What can I do to contribute outwardly? I can, again, inspire and model healthy adult relationships. So I have children. What are they seeing? What behavior am I modeling? What are they learning a relationship looks like? Not just to my children, but to other families and, again, my environment. So you find ways to expand or to extend your well-being outwardly. I'm a successful lawyer. That makes me happy. How can I extend that outwardly? I'm healthy and disciplined. That makes me happy. Extend it. I've got a good marriage. Extend it outwardly. So this is an ideal. Okay, so this is looking outwardly, but there's still a limitation to this. This is unselfishness. So unselfishness is far better than selfishness. Selfishness is far better than tamas or inertia. Beyond merely looking to improve the community that we are living in, we should look even more subtle than that, and that is working to improve our status as a human being, what we call self-development. So this is no longer being directed for the benefit of others. This is now being directed towards the growth of the individual. So self-development, we have a very simple definition. It's the reduction of egocentric desires and attachments. So what it means is that every area of life that we go into, every field of activity, we are naturally adopting a less self-interested perspective. So this is achieved through, again, the same fundamental law, as you think, so you become. And the ideal of self-development is promoted through three self-development channels or practices. The first is service. So we've covered that in the previous slide. What we've just talked about in contributing to a community, that is actually one of the channels of self-development as an individual. So that's for the physical body, for the actions that we perform. The second is for the mind. So this is devotion. So devotion is recognizing those areas of ignorance. When we recognize those things where our intellect is baffled, perplexed, we develop a sense of wonder. So the example that we've given in the past is, you imagine a young child looking up at the stars on a clear night, and his parent is describing how far away the stars are, what they're made of, how big they are, etc. There's a sense of wonder. Oh, wow. because there's an inability to really conceive it. And so the egocentric notions of my own limited egocentric perspective is suspended when we enter into this feeling of devotion. And so this is why he says, attuning to the beauty of nature is an amazing way to start to feel this devotion. As a way of leading into it, we can also implement a gratitude practice. So gratitude itself is not devotion. Gratitude is still ego-centered in the sense that we are saying, I'm glad for what I have. So it's still limited to really my own individual experience. But it still has this effect of getting us to recognize those areas outside of myself. I am a recipient of this benefit from outside me. I feel grateful. I have nothing to do with the fact that my physical body works. I was born reasonably healthy. A few little minor flaws here and there, but by and large, it's pretty good. I had nothing to do with that. Gratitude. I have running hot water in my home so I can practice washing my hands anytime I want. Why me? Why am I not born into another environment that doesn't have running water, doesn't have soap? I don't know. Gratitude. So that can help us lead in to this sense of wonder. And the third element is for the intellect, knowledge. So this essentially means being constantly curious about the deeper truths of life. We seek facts and truth and understanding. Not just in the material world, is this fact that I'm reading on my news feed true, but in terms of the mechanisms by which we experience life at all. Why do I experience my life the way that I do? What are the principles that underlie my experience, the choices that I make? So the path of knowledge is to consciously investigate and reflect, to have this intention to uncover facts and truth, and to turn those into understanding. So the question again, for what categories of my life should I set goals? For all of the categories that your own nature demands an expression, and that expression is through your attention and your action. You should set goals there that are in line with your specific nature, your swadharma, and then to ensure that those goals don't just become enclosed and a source of agitation, we should also implement ideals on the outside of them.